Don Francisco, I am confused about your nomination adelantado. Did that mean that you could conquer and govern past the Inca Empire, or was there a limit? As an adelantado, I was given the right to conquer from Rio Santiago in Ecuador to Chinche in Peru, a distance of approximately 250 leagues or 875 miles. So you had a limit as far as how far you could conquer. But after the conquest, you did not want to honor that clause of the capitulation, and you had to battle against Almagro. We didn't know exactly where Cusco was situated in relationship to Chincha, and Cusco is where all the gold was. Let me tell you of the other accolades that I also received. More titles than Francisco? Que va, the most important of all, my coat of arms that initially portrayed the solitude of the oceans with two galleons sailing to Tumbes. As the conquest continued, they added an Inca with shackles around his neck, with his hands on top of two coffers of gold, surrounded by seven Indians chained together from their necks. In time, they would also add a stone fortress depicting the great city of Cusco, then the coat of arms of Carlos Quinto, and the little seal of the Pizarros, with long pine trees supported by two bears. With that great seal, I was accepted as a member of my family, or better yet, they were part of my nobility. Our descendants would be known as the Marqueses of the Conquista. Don Francisco, to depict our people in fetters is the most disgraceful act that could have ever happened to your nation. And it shows the essence of what you were. Those degrading symbols should disappear from the face of the earth. Condor soul, what they engrave in my coat of arms are the same acts that are still being perpetrated by your own people. That is true. However, I cannot believe that Almagro was given the guardianship of Tumbes, since he was not even taken. He wanted the title of adelantado so he could continue on his own conquest after the limits of your governorship. The money that he was going to receive was probably less than what he put of his own for the expedition. Was he happy? Almagro was a very difficult man. In this case, he had all the reasons to be. It was not within my power to do differently. The crown didn't want to give the leadership to two captains. How about Bartolome Ruiz? He was named the Admiral of the Southern Seas, a title that he earned on his own right. That's all he got? No, he would be an alderman of the city of Tumbes with a yearly salary of 75,000 maravedis. And to his son, they gave him the high position of public notary. And how about Luque? He was given close to nothing. Oh no, he will be well endowed with the bishopric of Tumbes if the Pope approved. Meanwhile, he was named the protector of the Indians. Don Francisco, the fate of the Indians could have been better without any protectors. Que va, Indiano, don't pick on the priest. They are just men who want to do good, but some are also sinners like any of us. We're talking of the extermination of human beings and not of sinners. Condor soul, the annihilation of the Indians was the product of war. You call that war innocent and backward people as your adversaries? Look, the Indians were warriors. If they had won, that would have minced us to pieces, that were not the retarded society that seemed to imply. I'm surprised that you, as one of them, are so deprecating of your own people. This is the great seal of Francisco Pizarro, which is in Trujillo, that was taken by me while I was there. So, with the capitulation, you all obtained titles, but the sovereignty of the Incas was not even discussed. Mierda, we were not going to sign pacts or create marriage among princes of Europe with Indian nobles. Stop thinking of inconceivable unions. It was the will of God. What happened is happened to them has nothing to do with the will of God, but with the survival of the fittest. God knows the ones he makes the strongest. In any event, after having spent half a year dealing with the bureaucrats, we were able to conclude all the formalities. On July 29, 1529, the legal papers of the capitulation were signed in the absence of Carlos Quinto by his mother, Juana La Loca. However, I still got to recruit the men, but I found no one to hire. Many had died in the wars with Italy, and most had already gone to the Indies. I figured I could get them in Trujillo. It had been more than a quarter of a century, 27 years, since I left Spain. I wanted to go to the place where I was born. I was an Hidalgo, with all the privilege that a king could bestow on a man of humble beginnings like me. I was somebody. I wanted to meet my half-siblings, Fernando Pizarro, whom I knew as a child, and the only legitimate son in our lineage. He was 30 years of age. My two young brothers, Juan, 23 years old, and Gonzalo, a teenager, both from different mothers. I also found out that I had a brother from another father, Martin de Alcantara. What a family disorder. In those days, not a good situation to be in. Hernando was a noble on account of his legitimacy, but he was not wealthy. The others were destitute and very enthusiastic to come to America. That is why in this encounter you find me praying in this ancient cathedral of Trujillo. Not a bad idea to come to the place of my childhood to form a concept of myself. That was the main reason for my trip to the old world. Trujillo is a beautiful city. The people treated me well, especially Senorita Magdalena and Doña Toni, who introduced me to one of your present grand-grand-nephews. What does he look like? He's of average stature, well-learned, and cautious in his speech. I made the mistake of greeting him as a direct descendant of yours, since you were the object of my spiritual visit, to which he corrected me that he was of the lineage of Hernando Pizarro, perhaps letting me know of his true ascendancy. At least, I thought so. I don't want to misinterpret him. After all, I am an Indian with a past that needs to be explained. I was invited to the house of Doña Toni to have tea with your distant nephew. We talked till late hours of the night. I wrote a short essay to keep in perspective on how I felt about him. Let's hear it. What I composed is something personal. I may not make justice to him. You know how proud the Spaniards are. Yes, just like the Indians and mestizos. Perhaps you have the right to be. You were the conquerors with a questionable past that needs to be answered. Whereas we, the conquered, had a trajectory of humiliation that must cease, nevertheless. Nevertheless, this is what I wrote. Noble descendant of conquerors, you made me feel different. not because of your lineage, but for the forthrightness of your thoughts. You say that our problems are ours and not yours. I would agree in the present, but not in the past. For your forefathers subjugated the essence of our ancestors and bittered our souls. It is time that your people accept us. Francisco Pizarro did by taking Ines Huayla Yupanqui, an Inca princess, as his wife, swearing Doña Francisco Pizarro, a mestiza and a niece to Hernando Pizarro, with whom he married when she was 18 April and he was 52 years old. To which he answered, Hombre Americano, since the conquest of Mexico, our lineage has inherited Indian blood, and I am not ashamed of it. Did you discuss all these matters with him? Yes, Francisco, and his last statement is the irony of our encounter. He could have rejected the mingling of his ancestors with the Indians, yet he chose not to, contrary to the mestizos who do not accept their Indian heritage. They only embrace the little Spanish blood that is in them. I see that you still have ambiguous feelings towards us. You have been living in another country for so long. When are you going to forget what happened? I will, when the condors cease soaring to the unreachable mountains of hope. You are talking nonsense. Perhaps our encounter doesn't make any sense, but my trip to your past of birth did. The two ladies of Trujillo showed me your old city to understand its past, the crux of my visit. Pizarro's, Orellana's, Santiago, Santa Maria, an endless rosary of places and names etching history. This hamlet was the cradle of our conquistadors, and it also conquered my heart, gracious Senora Duran and the vicious Senora Galeana. You showed me your city that I so timidly carry in my being. With devotion, you spoke of your Lady of Victory, who protected Trujillo against the Moors, but she will not help us to get rid of our demons of the past. Over ancient stone pathways on narrow streets, we ascended to the door of triumph, from where I could see the green meadows of hope. Oh, Arco de Santiago, through its arch, daring men left to the Indies. With that legacy for the unknown, I also dare to venture to faraway places, not to conquer, but fleeing from my past. Oh, Trujillo, like your storks, help us descend gracefully from the treacherous peaks, and like your ravens croak to the world, I have nothing against the mother country of our disgrace. Trujillo of Spain is ours because we carry that city in our souls. Trujillo of Peru is yours because Pizarro's bones are in Lima. Man of the future, in anger you can express your repressed feelings disguised with words, but deep in your soul you would like to say, down with Spain, the stepmother of the Indians. No, Don Francisco, it is time that we all become one people, because that's what we are. Do you hear me? I am offering you the olive branches so that the Indians are part of mankind. What you are saying will only lead you to the impossibility of accomplishing your thoughts. Then what to do, Don Francisco? Your midways will get you nowhere, and what I am and why I am a man of action. By the way, talking of action, it is time that I return to America before some son of a bitch gets to Peru or worse. My partners go there on their own. But there are more obstacles that I have to overcome. The Council of the Indians promised me 250 men. 150 from the crown if they were true in their offerings, and 100 to be obtained in the new world if I could recruit them. Instead, they gave me 6 priests and 50 black slaves. They procured me 4 ships and 50 horses, but no money. It is half a year since the capitulation, and all I have are more priests than I need. Not only that, they told me that I could not take Moors or Jews, although there were many who wanted to come. They changed their names. I was able to bring them, and you could be a descendant of one of them. They also told me not to take those who had been prosecuted by the Inquisition. Válgame Dios, I wouldn't do that. Pedro de Candia, are we ready to leave? Captain, not yet. The inspectors have to certify that the ships are seaworthy, and if we have all the men before we can depart. That will take time, and we don't have enough men. What to do? Hernando, I have to live in the smaller boat with just enough sailors to man the sails. You will stay with the big ship and the great number of men for the final inspection. I will be waiting for you in the island of Gomera, where we are no longer accountable to the crown. Thus, with the capitulation of Toledo, a document that today would be worth no more than its weight in paper, he gave Pizarro the right to go and usurp an empire. What an injustice. Vamos, man of the future. That is the way it was. On January 19, 1530, I left for the Indies, as if I was running away from my own country. From Gomera, we sailed to Santa Marta, Colombia, where my men were told by its governor that the expedition to Peru was madness and they could get rich without going to unknown places to die. I sailed to Nombre de Dios. In the east side of Panama, with less men than I had brought, Almagro was waiting for me, and he was very concerned with the few grants that I was able to secure for him. He began to quarrel with Hernando, who was very critical of him. During the crossing of the isthmus to the city of Panama, many of my men died. My partners had been able to secure more men and ships. One of them was Hernando de Soto, a man of great wealth and courage who would join us later. With the other contingent, we were ready for final assault to the land of the Incas, this time as an expedition of annihilation and not a reconnaissance. It had taken Francisco Pizarro 6 months to sign the capitulation of Toledo, January to July 1529, half a year to get ready and sail to the New World, July to December, 1 year in Panama to prepare for the third expedition and start the cruelest of conflicts. But a conflict it was not. It would be the most sanguinary genocide ever, which dwarfs any other bloody event in the history of mankind. Holocaust are historical accounts, but to the Indian it happened. It has happened, and it continues to be perpetrated even by those who have suffered these tragic events in their own flesh. What befell us not only decimated our people, but all the indigenous civilization of the Americas. Unfortunately, the Indians are not a cohesive ethnic group able to liberate themselves. These days, no one is uttering one word on their behalf, and they are not of any concern to the world court. We have lost the yearning to cry to the four winds, and as the stones of our ruins, we no longer feel the flames of incandescent racism or the frigid indifference of mankind to our plight. We live on the universal God-given right of survival of the fittest. And there is no more veridical fact than the one we have been practicing since the beginning of time. Thus, it behooves the Indians to unite and fight for their rights, understanding that God looks after those who are willing to walk over the carcass of others, and our hopes will always be in the humanity of our inhumanity. Man of the future, the love of the strongest is a supreme mandate, and why I believe in a higher authority. With the blessings of the Almighty, we sail to Peru in December 1530 to do God's work. What an idiocy. You thought that you had his blessings to destroy a civilization, and that what pretense? For his glory, and just like the Crusaders, we will also massacre the infidels with the church blessings. Maybe the Creator wanted to be that way. Let us hope that someday humanity will have some mercy for the Indians. I wish I could call you an idealist, but you are a sacrilegious heretic. Don Francisco, I am a mestizo. I have some Spanish blood. Unlike your Quixote, I also would like to fight against these windmills of injustice. For now, we have to say goodbye. I will not see you until you are in the land of the Incas, and the rest will be the history of Peru. Coincidental with the departure of Pizarro, the Incas were embroiled in a civil war. My soul goes to encounter the last and legitimate sovereign. Huascar, your father's mommy is arriving from Quito. Are you going to celebrate his entrance? Man of the future, are you still with us? Where have you been? You seem to be disconnected with events that are taking place in Cusco. I fear that the worst is going to come from my own subjects. Inca, I have been the land of the people who are coming to conquer your empire. It is them, and not your subject, who you must fear. I am the lord of the land. No shaman like you is going to forecast our end. Huascar, in this trip to your past, we should try to understand the reasons for our downfall. Perhaps our tragic destiny began after your father died of the pestilence brought by the invaders. How could he have contracted their disease if he was never in contact with them? Oh no, the strangers have been exploring in the north for a considerable time in order to come to the heart of the empire. The coastal people were the first ones to come in contact with the foreigners and brought them your father indirectly, and from them, your father indirectly contracted the disease. He suffered a horrible death on account of the plague, and also because he never knew if they were demigod or just usurpers. He had rumors of both. Unfortunately, his own subjects allowed the invaders to explore the coast of the empire, unlike other nations farther north, who fought the explorers everywhere they stopped. But then they were savages who perhaps understood more about freedom than the civilized Incas did. That is why we have never trusted the northerners. You have to start to think of all of you as one people, especially now that you are going to confront a common enemy with a different way of thinking. It behooves you to know that once there were certain of the existence of the Inca Empire, they left not for good, but to return with more resources and subjugate your nation. Why are you telling me all these unwelcome events? Just let it take its course as it happened. I do this in order to understand who we were as people and why we lost as a race. Lost as a race? We were the Incas. For that reason, you succumb to them, like the mestizos who think of themselves other than Indians when both of them are the same. In spite of what you're saying, I will take care of the strangers if they come. Before I do that, I have to get rid of my own enemies who are in Cusco and in Quito. Lamentably, your descendants are going to pay for the consequences of your politics of persecution. Junto Sol, if you don't know yet, we're not united. I am going to put an end to this anarchy that is destroying us. Inca, you should know that to these days we're still a disunited country. Perhaps I should call you a man of doom for being so negative about us. Let us continue and you will understand why I am a man without hope. I understand that as soon as you found out that your father died, you appointed your own high priest, Chalcoyupanqui, to crown you. I did that because the center of the empire is Cusco, and Huaynacapa promised me the crown. Your father took your brothers to the north, who fought at his side. He probably realized that one of them was abler than you were to be a king. Man of the future, whoever is going to lead this land has to be from Cusco and reside in this sacred city. I don't trust anyone who's 8 months away and has nothing in common with us. As it is, my father and Inakuyochi are dead. I hope that you are not implying that Atahualpa should be the next in line. Sapa Inca, the funeral party of your father's money will be arriving in the outskirts of Cusco. Chuquiwaman and Cusiatauchi, go and accompany the funeral procession in their last trek. Let me know if there are any unusual activities in their entourage. For the last time, a triumphant Inca warrior, although a mummy, crossed the Apurimac River. Once in Limatambo, the intrigues began. Nobles, Huascar is not fit to be the king. We should get rid of him and crown Cusiatauchi, his younger sibling. Chuquiwaman, we know that Huascar is a lecherous man, but who is going to dethrone him? I will personally go to Cusco and carry out his demise, but Cusiatauchi shouldn't know of our plans. Once Huascar is dead, I will return and crown his brother. Chuquiwaman, instead of doing what he had planned, he told Huascar that his brother and the other nobles were planning to kill him. I knew it. I can't even trust my own family. Go and get rid of all those rebels, including my brother. Huascar, shouldn't you first inquire who is behind this plot against you? Kuntersol, I have to support anybody who may appear. Kuntersol, I have to suspect anybody who might appear in the least to be a traitor. Chuquiwaman became Huascar's confidant, and he began to question the nobles of the north and their torture. Collatopayupanqui, High Priest of Quito, why is Atahualpa not accompanying the mummy of his father? He hasn't come because many nations in the north are not completely subdued, and we don't have a representative of the Inca in Quito. Atahualpa is requesting that Huascar names him his second in command to keep the empire intact. No, we know that Atahualpa wants to revolt against Huascar. I will get the truth from all of you. with the unrefined techniques of a Spaniard inquisitor, Chuquihuaman proceeded with the gruesome task of torturing the nobles of the north who had nothing to confess, till his last breath, Collatopa denied any rebellion against Huáscar. Sapa Inca, the Quitos have not revealed anything. All I have obtained are these presents from Atahualpa with a message that you name him your representative in the north. Liars, I still have my mother from whom I can obtain some information about Atahualpa's intentions. Man of the future, the punishment that I have inflicted on ours and their nobles is going to serve as an exemplary lesson to all those who want to rebel against me. I will be the most feared Inca. Huáscar, how could you begin your watch of the empire by committing such atrocities? What I did was to keep the empire intact. Huáscar, my son, the distrust that you harbor for the Northerners goes beyond my understanding. Queen Mother, tell me why Atahualpa didn't accompany my father's funeral. If he wanted to be my representative, he should have come. He didn't because the Cañaris and the Chachapoyas are not completely subjugated. Atahualpa knows who are our enemies in the north, just as you know who are yours in the south. Mother, you are on Atahualpa's side. To avoid any question of my legitimacy, you are going to marry the mommy of Huayna Capa. He is my brother. I consorted with him after his wife died. No, Kusirimai was his rightful wife. You were only his concubine, and I'm not his legitimate son, so that no one will question my right to the throne. I will also marry your daughter, who is my sister. Huáscar, I will wed the mommy of your father, but I will not allow you to espouse my daughter. Mother, you know that I cannot be the Sapa Inca unless I join in wedlock to my sister. No, she and I cannot become part of your hideous scheme. Chuquihuaman, I need your advice. The Queen Mother will not consent to my marrying my sister. Without this union, I cannot be a bona fide Inca lord. Sapa Inca, Chalcoyupanqui, your high priest, can offer sacrifices on your behalf. Your mother will not oppose the will of her idols. Rawa Opium, Huasca's mother, had no other choice but to accept. The wedding took place in Limatambo. As lawful consorts, the dead Inca with his living wife at his side entered Cusco with all the pomp befit for a victorious warrior. In the midst of the macabre celebration, Huáscar married his sister, Chuquihuipa. Huáscar was now the sole and rightful Sapa Inca. No one could claim the crown unless he was ready to fight for his crown. The only one who could challenge was his half-brother in Quito. Thus, we had a Caligula in the north and a Nero in the south, both of whom would proceed to end the empire as the Romans did with theirs. But Atahualpa and Huáscar would destroy the empires with the help of Neptune, on whose water the invaders were coming. Huáscar, you are neglecting to go on your trips of reconnaissance of your kingdom. Custer Sol, I will. But for all the people who should have been here was not present. Respect to the Inca Lord must be done in person. Atahualpa has disobeyed that mandate. Perhaps he didn't come because he needs to represent you in the north. So far you have not answered him, and Atahualpa doesn't know what to do. I don't care. From this moment on, any friend of his is an enemy of mine. Inca, terror is the wrong course to lead the people. Don't make matters worse by letting everyone know of your paranoid state. You call paranoid taking care of one's own interest? Meanwhile, the runners got a message for Huascar. Sapa Inca, Atahualpa has sent two women to spend time with the queen and her daughter. Rawa Ocho, what are these women doing here? Are they emissaries from Quito? Yes, they are. Atahualpa thinks that they may be able to get to your heart better than he can. Mother, you are planning something against me. From now on, you and my sister will be under my strict supervision. Tell these women to return before I get rid of them. Meanwhile, Huascar sent Chuqui Huaman on an expedition of pacification to the north instead of going himself. His confidant tried to betray the Inca again. The Chachapoyas, aware of his treason, and to gain acceptance from Huascar, decapitated Chuqui Huaman, and they allied with the Inca. Atahualpa was also carrying an expedition of his own in the northwest. He crossed to Puna, and he lost to the Inlanders. He took refuge in Tumbes, where he heard reports of the strangers. The news of the foreigners infiltrating the empire did not interest him because of the prospect of an imminent civil war. Atahualpa sent a second embassy consisting of a mutual cousin, Quilaco, who on his way to Cusco dared to carry an amorous affair with the daughter of Huascar. Novos, where are the emissaries of Quito? Sapa Inca, they are still in Siquilla Pampa, where your daughter is. Quilaco spent some time with her. Tell the emissaries to come to Calca instead of Cusco. I will take care of them without the interference of my wife. Sapa Inca, remember that the young prince is the son of Auquitopa Yupanqui, the great general and older brother of Huayna Capac. Once in Calca, Huascar confronted him. Quilaco, I know you have been busy with Curi Collor. As my vassal and ambassador at Atahualpa, your first official act of state was to fornicate with my daughter. Great Huascar, Chuquihuipa is like my sister to me. I don't care. Any Nahual from Quito is a traitor. Sapa Inca, Atahualpa, and I only wish to serve you. Then why didn't he come? Because your ire would have been inflamed with his presence. All he wants is that you officially name him your representative. If you don't, he will not be credible in the north. If he had come in person, perhaps I would have allowed him to be my second in command in Quito. Atok, get the truth from the other nobles. If they have no answers, torture them. Quilaco, I will spare you. Let's be Atahualpa's last embassy. The next one I will kill all of them. Take this feminine clothes to Atahualpa as a present from me. His cousin left to the north. Huascar, the foreign invaders are coming. If you two brothers are divided, the empire will fall. Man of Doom, those strangers whom the coastal people are talking about are just rumors. I will not believe until I see them. I warn you that Huayna Capac prognosticated that he might be the last emperor. Don't you believe in the augurs of the dying? My father's predictions were due to his hallucinations caused by the poison given to him by the Quitos. Huáscar, how I wish the invaders came when your father was alive and you two brothers had solved your problems. Why, Man of Doom? Because Huaynacapa, as a sole leader, would have confronted a few foreigners. As it is going to happen, your carcasses will never be mummies for being stubborn Indians. I thought you were not going to use that derogatory label imposed on us. Let that name be our curse for not being united. Kundersol, we're humans, and this unity is common to mankind. Huáscar, proof that we're not part of humanity is that we're now Indians. Kundersol, of all unlikely possibilities of our downfall, you have chosen my faulty personality, knowing that empires rise and fall. Maybe it's time for ours to end. Why do you think the moment has come? Because the Panaka dynasties of the dead Inca lord have taken the key places of the great square of Aucaipata. I have no more space to build a palace for my posterity. Since no one can remove them, I have to go to the highest of Colcampata, far from the political center in the sacred city. It is the accumulation of 11 dead emperors in key places who are going to be the cause of our demise. I can do anything without interfering with the caretakers who yield more power than I do in this city of the dead. I will do away with all of them, but first I have to get rid of Atahualpa. Huáscar, respect for the dead is one of the most profound feelings that any individual or society has. A nation that disdains its ancestor will never be united, and we, your descendants, seem to be following in your same footsteps. To synchronize these events, a trip from Quito to Cusco took months, according to the purpose and who was doing it. If there were Chasqui runners, probably weeks. If we assume that it took 8 months for the funeral entourage of Huaynacapa to reach Cusco, March to December 1528, 6 months for the first embassy to July 1529, and another 6 months for the Quilcos party near early 1530, which was the time when Francisco departed from Spain to America. In the first months of 1531, the third expedition left from Panama to conquer Peru. In that time, the Inca's brothers had to decide, either Atahualpa comes to Cusco, risking to be killed, or he realizes that he had already done so, that he could become the Inca lord of Quito without the blessings of his brother. Quilaco, what news do you bring from my brother? Great Atahualpa, actions speak for themselves. Let the nobles come in and see for yourself what is left of your embassy. Oh, this is horrible. What happened to the others? They were killed. Here are the presents that Huáscar sent to you. What is this? Women's clothes for me, and only half of my embassy left. This is a declaration of war. There will be no more delegations. Chalcochima, Quisquis, and Rumiñahui, my faithful generals, were being dispossessed of the empire. I will not be a representative of Inca in the north. What should I do? Great Atahualpa, we should have revolted a long time ago. We have the whole army to defeat them. The north will be under your leadership as the Lord of Quito. Sapa Inca, a mission from the Cañaris has come all the way from the north to pay their respects. Atok, let them in. Great Huáscar, our old Curaca is dead. We have come for your approval of our new leader. We didn't want to infuriate you by asking Atahualpa to recognize him. Atok, The Cañaris are with us. Atahualpa will not be able to keep Tumibamba. All he can have is Quito, which is not a loss for us. However, he can easily defeat them, take Cajamarca and advance to Cusco. Perhaps, and in retrospect, the Cañaris were the missing link who started the Civil War. Atahualpa spoke to his generals. Warriors of Quito, this is going to be an all-out conflict. The Cañaris have aligned with the Cuscos, knowing well that their old leader, although my enemy, was allied with me. We will take possession of Tumibamba. Surreptitiously, the empire was divided into two factions by an astute brother with the most dedicated generals who had lived most of their lives in the north. It would be easy to say that Atahualpa and Huáscar were the sole cause of the fallen empire, but we must take into account that the civil wars are the inevitable adjustment that civilization or nations have to go through in their political involvement to either their greatness or downfall. Both Incas had their own ideas on how to create a better system of government. Atahualpa, as a warrior, wanted to expand to other nations. Huáscar, a politician, felt that the accumulation of past dynasties was to be eliminated. The two brothers were on the right path, but if they had only worked together. How did this civil war start? History is anecdotal. Supposedly, Huáscar sent an envoy to apprehend his brother. He was taken prisoner, but somehow he was able to escape. Atahualpa felt that this was not an event to go unnoticed. He concocted the story that his getaway was a divine act, stating that he was transformed into a snake and he crawled through a hole. Now the North had a divine leader like Manco Capac, who came out of the waters of Lake Titicaca. Seeing the aberration of this divinity, the Cañaris and the Chachapoyas informed Huáscar. Junto Sol, as I suspected, Atahualpa has seceded from the empire. Huáscar, the predicament in which you find yourself is due to your harsh leadership. Man of the future, we have to be severe with all of those who oppose the one in power. Isn't that the same case in your times? Those are the dictators who create mass graves of dissenters, and in their majority are Indians. The Lord of Quito named his generals. Chalcochima, I am naming you my general and Quisquis your captain. We will pay dearly if we are not successful against the Incas. Great Atahualpa, we will fight for you as we did for your father. Don't forget that we will be battling against the Incas and not the savage of the north. Great Atahualpa, we will advance south while you take care of the administration of the north. Quisquis, you are more of a northerner than a southerner. If we're victorious, we have to decide which side we belong to. Chalcochima, at one time we lost to the inlanders of Puna. We must go back to them. Before we do that, we should first take possession of Tumbes, their historical enemies. The coast of Sirio Tumbes was taken by Atahualpa. Lord Quito, the warriors of Puna have allied with Huáscar, and they are continually coming to attack us. Now that we're part of your army, let us cross the Gulf to their island. The Punas and the Quitos fought, and Atahualpa was injured. He abandoned the island, leaving 600 Tumbesinos. The Punas under the Curaca Tumbala disembarked in Tumbes, and they ransacked the town. However, not everything was lost for the Quitos. The island Puna and Tumbes were not great loss for Atahualpa. He knew that he had to fight Huáscar in the Andes, where victory would have to be decided in the Cordilleras and not on the coast. Atok, my Inca general, Atahualpa has lost in Punak and he has abandoned the Tumbes. You should go and defeat the Quito Lord with the help of the Cañaris. The general Huascar departed to Tumibamba, confident that he would be victorious. The Quito fought Huascar, General Atok. Atahualpa, we have lost against the Cuscos and their Cañari accomplices. Chalcochima, prepare my troops. I personally will apprehend my half-brother, Atok, and castigate these Cañaris allies. The Inca general lost. Sapa Inca, the Cañaris have sent you an envoy from the north. Let them in. Great Huascar, we have lost Atahualpa, your brother, Atok, and our Curaca leader have been taken prisoners. We are at the risk for all for allying with you. Go back, tell your people that Atok's expedition was not intended to be a full-scale war against Atahualpa. Since the conflict has degenerated into an all-out war, I will send my great Inca general, Huancauqui, to rejoin the retreating troops of Atok. In this trip to the past, I have my first encounter with the enigmatic Lord of the North. Atahualpa, I don't know under what title to address you. Man of the future, I am the Lord of Quito. I know that you have spent some time with Huascar and you are with him. I'm not siding with this, either one of you, but I am concerned that both of you are fighting while strangers are on their way to conquer the empire. Oh, you are referring to the bearded man. They have come and gone long time ago. Atahualpa, the people from the old world are returning to invade your lands. Nonsense. Have this chicha to celebrate our first meeting. Atahualpa, this is a human skull. I'm not going to drink from such a vase, even if it's lined with a gold. Curtosol, this was a dog skull. You may want to use the remains of your enemies as a sign of revenge. But using your brother's skull for that purpose is something I cannot comprehend. To hell with the Incas, our fortress in the northern island lands. Cusco is too far and too distant in our hearts. Atahualpa, I'm afraid that I will have to meet you again when your arrogance is chained to the new masters. You will be the last Inca who could have been king, and with you, our hopes will be banished forever. My first meeting with the Lord of Quito had ended. He was muscular and had a petulant face and bloodshot eyes. His conversation was detached. Somebody had to do the talking for him so as not to face the person who was addressing to him. Unlike Huascar, who was sociable, probably because he had never been exposed to the harshness of the elements and the cruelties of war. Huancauqui, we're losing. Atok is dead. The Cañaris are our strong allies, fear for their own survival. Take all the warriors you can muster and go north to avenge the death of our brother. Help will never be farther than where you are. Sapa Inca, I fear that my bad luck is greater than my desire to do the best for you. His new general left to the north. Huascar, you are no different than Atahualpa when it comes to doing away with your own brothers. In the end, both of you are going to lose everything. Can you understand that? Man of the future, as long as Atahualpa is alive, I don't care if it costs me the empire to get rid of him. Huancauqui left Cusco with his captain, Huacamaita and Awampanti. He had explicit orders to fight Atahualpa in Quito once he reached Tumibamba. He stayed there instead of continuing to Quito, and he was destroyed by Huascar. Loro Quito, Wankauki, Huascar's new general, is in the north and he wants to negotiate with you. Chalco Chima, should I go to him? No, great Atahualpa. The Incas are exhausting themselves by coming north. This is the time to take Tomibamba and advance to Cusco. Cutter Sol, I might still be able to avert war. After all, you are for negotiations. Yes, Huancalqui, but you have come as a man of war and not as an ambassador. Do you think that Atahualpa is going to come without an army after what Huascar did to his emissaries? Man of the future, that is why I have to negotiate with strength and fight if I have to. The pact did not take place. The Quito surprised them. Huancalqui retreated to Cusibamba to reorganize and prevent the Quitos from marching to Cajamarca. Atahualpa took Tomibamba, killing many of the Cañaris. In anger, Huascar sent women close to his three captains for losing the war. Without the Cañaris as their allies, Huancalqui stood alone in the north, unless the Chachapoyas took Huascar's cause. History is confusing at this point. The opposing parties took a reprieve, perhaps to form an alliance or to tend to their fields. After some time, Atahualpa generals began their restless persecution of Huascar's forces. Meanwhile, 4 months into the third expedition, the Spaniards had covered 2/3 of distance to Tumbes, settling in Coaqui, close to the equinoctial line. Don Francisco, I see that you're finally going to fulfill your destiny and seal the fate of the Incas. Man of the future, this time I am an Hidalgo and I will be the governor of Nueva Castilla. Don Francisco, remember that I am a man of the Americas. Titles mean nothing to me, even if given by kings, for glory is fleeting, and one's actions have to be reconciled with our conscience and not by the adulations of someone or of the masses. Condor Sol, that is what we Spaniards live for, sometimes poor but with titles, and if rich, so much the better. Drawing of the persecution of Huascar and the fight among them. We respect your idiosyncrasies. Do the descendants from the old world respect ours? I know you have plenty of reasons to be angry for what we did or are about to do in this encounter. After we commended our souls to the Lord on January 20th, 1531, we left Panama on our third expedition on 3 ships with 180 men, 50 horses, and hundreds of ferocious dogs. Leave the Almighty alone. He's not a partner in this carnage that you plan to commit. Otherwise, he would not be God, would he? Indiano, just wait until you get where I am, then you will know what hell is like. You mean to say that where you are is not a world of nothingness? Because existing any form and anywhere is better than the emptiness that is awaiting for us. Let us not talk of something that no one knows beyond our terrestrial existence, and why we must believe in the Supreme Maker. Tell me, where did you get 180 men? You have many deserters, and nobody wanted to join you. Yes, and only the aged wanted to come. I avoided them because it's better to teach the young than to strengthen the old. But I still brought a few of them along with some of the 13 of fame. With the great pile of Bartolome Ruiz, we sailed to the Island of Pearls. Here we contemplated what course to take. We decided not to stop in any of the places where he stayed before. We anchor on the Bay of San Mateo, Ecuador, on February 11th. It took months to achieve what had taken us years to get to this place. Someday you should reenact this voyage so that you understand what we went through to conquer your people. You are blaming the whole world for their problems. How about the butchery committee among themselves? I told you once, the worst enemy of the Indians are the Indians and the mestizos. As you have said, they were savages. What is your excuse? You have the wisdom of the ages and the guidance of a true God. So we alone are not to be blamed. Don Francisco, that is what I've been trying to tell you. This is not an encounter to place culpability on your own people by finding ways of mending what your world did to us and what we're doing to ourselves in an occupied new world. Cynical words to express what you feel about us. We stayed in Coaqui, suffering hunger and disabling disease. Being short of supplies, I sent some ships to the Isle of Pearls to get provisions, a second to Panama to pay our debts, and a third to Nicaragua to bring more soldiers, horses, dogs, and Indian slaves. Sometime after, a caravel arrived with the bureaucrats who were left in my hasty departure from Spain. I continued by land, causing terror so that the savage knew who we were. Don Francisco, from the beginning, your men were killing and plundering. Condor Sol, I knew that fear, devastation, and the systematic extermination of the Indians was the only tactic to subdue the Indians. That happened in the northern latitudes. What's going to happen with the Inca civilization? Que va, all Indians are the same, whether they were civilized or not. I was not going to rest until we got rid of them, or they became Christians. In your times, it was very convenient to do evil deeds in the name of the Almighty, and we're still marginalizing the Indians for some misconceived ideas like the so-called illegal immigration by none others than the people who came from the old world to the new continent illegally in the first place. Man of the future, we didn't have to have any excuses to annihilate them. Besides, the Indians sacrifice their own for their idols, while we kill for a true God. Then all of you adventurers were just as savage as the Indians were for not respecting the human rights of others. Condor Sol, the Indians were not conquered with idealism, but with the sword and the cross. That has been the fate of the natives, with or without gods. Meanwhile, the Spaniards had reached Ecuador. Lord of Quito, the bearded men are crossing the Gulf of Guayaquil to the island of Puna. I hope those islanders fight the intruders. When I am finished with Huascar, I will take care of the strangers. Tumbala, the Curaco Puna, who was aware of their previous expedition, sent in boys to prevent the Spaniards from disembarking on their island. Tumbala offered Pizarro large balsas to traverse the channel of Huayna Capac. Francisco was alerted that they had intentions of untying the balsas and letting him drown. In distrust, Pizarro asked that Tumbala himself navigate the channel with him. The cacique accepted, hoping to get rid of all of them once in the island. As soon as the expedition set foot on Puna, they began to command a land that was not theirs, committing injustice against the inhabitant, as Cieza says. The occupiers liquidated the natives with their dogs, using the wounded and dying to keep the animals well fed. Infuriated, Tumbala sent archers to open holes in their ships, but they were unable to sink any. In response, the Spaniards with a few mounted lancers went after 15 Curaca nobles and their 3,500 warriors. The islanders were able to kill two soldiers and the horse of Hernando Pizarro, who was quick to bury the animal so that the natives would not find out that they were beasts of burden. The nobles and Tumbala were taken prisoners. Few warriors were able to escape and got lost in the marshlands to continue fighting. On one side note, I went to visit the present island of Puna, a peaceful city that has remained perhaps as it was. At the center of the plaza, there is a statue of Tumbala, placed by Felipe II in 1660, with a plaque giving the cacique thanks for being helpful to the Spaniards when they first arrived. What an irony. So is history on what lets it be distorted. Here's the picture of Tumbala in the Puna. I took that picture myself. Hernando, the islanders are fighting a guerrilla warfare. We will not be able to exterminate them. Send an envoy to tell the Tumbesinos to come, and we will make the pact with them as his guests. Francisco gave them the 15 nobles to do as they please with them. To seal their alliance, Pizarro returned the 600 Tumbesinos who were taken prisoners when they were fighting under Atahualpa. Thus, the islanders were the first to dispel the assumption that the strangers were demigods. Atahualpa was informed of what had happened, and he understood that the invaders were mere mortals. Loro Quito, Huanca Auqui is retreating to Cajamarca. Chalcochima, go after them. I will stay in the north with my generals, Rumiñahui, Eye of Stone. I continue southward according to how the war progresses. Meanwhile, the Incas were desperately looking for allies. Chachapoyas, we need your help to fight against Atahualpa so that he can save your lives and win the empire. The Chachapoyas ally with the Incas. In the carnage, thousands of Chachapoyas lay dead. The generals of Huascar, with a few of their warriors, began their desperate retreat to Cusco, followed by the relentless Quito generals. Atahualpa established his new center of action in Cajamarca. While waiting news from his generals, he went to Huamachuco to hear the oracles from a wizard who was accepted only if he had good augurs to prognosticate. Shaman, what is in the future for me? Loro Quito, you will never be the Zapa Inca. You wretched old man, don't you know that we're almost at the doors of Cusco? You are with Huascar, and for that, you are going to die. You may do as you wish with me, but you and your brothers will never reign the empire of the sun. The Wiracochas are getting ready to sail to Tumbes, if they are not already there. The coastal people and the islanders have been asking for your help, but you have not assisted them against the stranger. Some are already forming alliances with them. You despicable old man, these Macanames will silence you. The shaman fell at the rattling sounds of his seashell's ornaments. Atahualpa ordered that the city be razed to the ground. And here's another picture of Atahualpa and Huascar on their retreat. Waman, Huanca Auqui, you are relieved for losing to the northern generals. With fewer warriors, Mayta Yupanqui, the new Inca general, confronted the thousands of Quitos, and he also lost. Without reinforcements and no hope of victory, He retreated to Vilcas, not far from Cusco. Huáscar was very alarmed. Oh, Chalco Yupanqui, the Iquitos are here. What to do? Nothing is going to save us. Great Huáscar, we still have a chance to win if you take command of our troops. I knew it. I should have personally confronted Atahualpa. The Inca implored, Sacred Huaca Huanacauri, your sanctuary and my life are at stake. I will make great sacrifices if I am victorious. If I am not, the Inca dynasty will end. Huáscar knew that the empire was lost. However, he would prevail if he had Pachacuti's intuition to save Cusco. He fought and the Iquitos lost. Huáscar's hopes were renewed. His kiss, Cusco may not be ours after all. The Incas have control of the bridge. We have to fight them in Cotabamba. Huáscar had proved to be a good tactician. With his captain Topatown, the Incas fought in Cotabamba from sun up to sun down. The victor was again Huáscar. In haste, Chalco Chima troops ran to the hill, covered with high and dry grass. Huáscar has won two battles. His genius as a warrior or his stupidity as the son of the sun will decide the final outcome. He sent warriors to burn the hill. The night fell and the sky glowed. As the sun rose, the cinders of death turned into embers of hope for the northerners. Huáscar had made the fateful decision of not going in after the fire ceased. Instead, he waited until midday to finish with the remaining Iquitos, who had not perished in the inferno. The desire to celebrate his glory while Inti was shining was more important to him than going after them when he should have. Topatau, go after the Iquitos who have survived. I will follow you with a few of my novels and enter the ravine to claim victory. Chalco Chima survived and made his logistic plans. His kiss. We made a good decision in not returning to Quito. The few Inca warriors who went to apprehend the Iquitos were surprised and Topatau was taken prisoner. The Iquitos went back to the hills to wait for Huáscar's arrival while the sun was at high noon. Kiskis, look at that statue of the sun in a litter. Chalco Chima, that is Huáscar, dressed in his golden attire. He's coming to claim victory. Iquitos, do you see that man who shines in that litter? He's Huáscar. We must take him prisoner. Once his golden diadem falls, the Inca will be without a leader. The Incas will be without a leader. The Iquitos ran down from the hills and took Huáscar prisoner. We are the victors. Kiskis, do not sing glory yet. There are still troops at the entrance of the bridge. We have to defeat them before we can enter Cusco. Chalco Chima, dress yourself with the golden attire of Huáscar and go in his litter to the encampment of the Cuscos. We will follow you as if we were his prisoners. When we get there closer, we will attack them. The Incas waited for their warriors. As the false entourage got closer, the Cuscos noticed that Huáscar was not the Inca lord, but Chalco Chima dressed in Huáscar regalia. Precipitously, the Inca warriors began to run in the direction of the distracted city. Having received the news of the fall of Huáscar, Huancaoqui fought one more battle against the Iquitos inside Cusco, but his karma was faithful to him, and for the last time he lost. Who knows? Had Huáscar won Could he have emerged as the second Pachacutec? The world has only one Caesar, one Alexander, and one Napoleon. Those who follow after them are only emulators who fill the page of history, but not the hearts of the people. Inti had given one Pachacutec to save Cusco, but he denied Huáscar the honor of preserving the empire. The Incas were treading the last knots of their history and the streams of their keep of writings. The Civil War was over. The future of Pizarro never seemed so fortuitous. Don Francisco, you have decimated the natives of Puna for reasons that are not clear in the souls of men. Condor Sol, it was my brother, who believes that the Indians are subhumans. How about Soto? Does he think the same? Que va, he has been in the New World longer than my brother. In Nicaragua, they call him the butcher of the Indians. He has money and power. I don't know why he's here, if not to exterminate the natives. Soto was not the gentleman that the history wants us to believe he was. After the conquest of Peru, he went to North America, where he died in the Mississippi River. Now, that is an extremeño with cojones all the way to his water grave. In the first day of April 1532, having no more islanders to exterminate, the Spaniards decided to cross to Terra Firme. Hernando, pick up our most courageous men. The Punas will take you to Tumbes. Once you secure a strand on the beach, we will go and disembark. In four balsas, Hernando Pizarro, Hernando de Soto, Cristóbal de Mena, and Benalcázar navigated the Gulf. As they got closer to Tumbes, the islanders began to untie the balsas. Hernando de Soto and Cristóbal de Mena, who were at the head of the expedition, managed to reach to shore. Believing that the Tumbesinos would help them, three of their men jumped on land. The warriors of Tumbes killed the three Spaniards. Soto, seeing what happened to his commander, spent the night on the high seas. Next day, Pizarro's ship arrived. They disembarked and unleashed their powerful cavalry. Unable to fight against a force never seen, the Tumbesinos retreated to hide in the valles of Tumbes. But Tumbes was taken, and mass was celebrated in front of a wooden cross. Don Francisco, you have just consecrated the first massacre of Peru and killed innocent people who protected what was theirs. It is difficult to understand our great capacity to thrive on the injustice committed against others. We don't seem to learn from our disgraceful acts for the benefit of mankind. Contra Sol, that is history. That is the history of humanity, and we will never change. In Tumbes, the Spaniards took the native leaders prisoners. As Chiesa tells us, they constantly admonished Quilamasa for killing three of their men after they themselves had butchered thousands of Indians. Quilamasa, tell me where and how to find the Lord of Quito. Wiracocha Francisco, go south on the great desert, turn east, climb the Hell Mountains, and they will tell you where Atahualpa is. His whereabouts are changing day by day due to the Civil War. The doors to the empire have been opened, and a surface left in the direction indicated by Quilamasa. Lord of Quito, the bearded men have landed in Tumbes, and the Tumbesinos are asking you for help. Atahualpa, who was on his way to Cusco, ordered to let the invaders continue their march, and he returned to Cajamarca to wait for them. Don Francisco, all you have to do is apprehend Atahualpa. And like Cortez did with Montezuma, take the Inca hostage. Your words are Attila, who sacked cities, but he did not destroy civilizations. Keva, this is the new world. There are no civilizations here but savages. The Indians were not united to fight against us. Don Francisco, the empire was no different than the old Spain with its feudal lords who were not united either, and why it took them so long to get rid of the Moors. Condor Sol, we were the same people. Although the Moors were our enemies, we still coexisted. There must be something in common with the natives in the new world. This is a picture of Tumbes, first time it was taken. I didn't see any use for the Indians other than to serve us as slaves and to feed them to our dogs. Did you learn anything from Filipino? All I know that Indian could kill one of his own race if we asked them to do so. What else could he have done? He had to survive. That is where we differ. We're willing to fight and die for our people. While you Indians and mestizos are capable of killing your own for others. The Spaniards left to Tumbes and marched to Poecos in May 1st, 1532, leaving 26 soldiers. Francisco encountered their leader, who was not too happy to see the invaders. The Curacas heard that the Spaniards took a city with a sword and fire. Marca Vilca, regardless of what you think of us, we will stay in your city. First, you have to swear allegiance to the crown and accept our guard. Wiracocha Francisco, I will repeat anything that you ask me to say, as long as you don't kill my people or burn our fields. The notary read the requirement. Filipillo, are you translating the requerimiento? If as is written for these Indians. Yes, Don Francisco. Filipillo coerced the Curaca to answer positively. Marca Vilca, tell the strangers that you will do as they say, even if you don't comprehend their rules, or you will die. This Indian has said yes. Filipillo, what else did you tell him? We never know if what you're translating is what the crown and the church want of them. Francisquillo, did he repeat what the notary read? Yes, Capito, word by word. This Indian leader has sworn to abide by the requirement. And what are you too, if not Indians like him? Don Francisco, we're Christians, we speak Castilian, and we're no longer one of them. Condor Sol, these two translators are now refined. Any Indian like them is always a good ally. Don Francisco, 500 years later, we're still a nation of refined Indians and pretentious mestizos who are not different than the translators. You are also a refined Indian. No, Don Francisco, I am a learned man. Because you can read and write, does that make you better than an Indian? It goes deeper than that. I am an enlightened man because I accept my Indianism. Vamos, an Indian, even if educated, will always be an Indian. Marca Vilca, tell us where Atahualpa is. Wiracocha Francisco, go to Cajas and Huancabamba and you will get some more information of his whereabouts. Indio, are you sure you are not sending us to our death? That I don't know. You will encounter the nobles of Chira and Motupe who have even rebelled against the Incas. The Spaniards were on their way to Cajamarca. Meanwhile, the victorious Quito general commanded that all nobles in Cusco receive their round of justice. Nobles of Huascar, The Civil War is over. What happened in the empire was a conflict between two brothers to see who was the most able. Atahualpa won. This is the age of the great Tixicapa. As Chalcochima finished with his apparent conciliatory message, Huáscar was already feeling the harsh lashes of their justice. Cuscos, kneel down. Pull your eyelashes and blow them north where Atahualpa is. The ritual finished, the Inca nobility were surrounded by the Quito generals. Chalco Yupanqui, why did you crown Huáscar knowing that Atahualpa was the most capable? I did because Huáscar was chosen to inherit the crown before Huayna Capac's departure to the north. General Huancaoqui, we practically know the size of your sandals. We have been following your footprints all the way from Quito. Mama Rawa, you are not the Coya Queen. You were just another conquered wild Huayna Capac, and Huáscar is not your legitimate son. Give this urine to him, he's thirsty. The nobility of Cusco had to suffer the blows of justice of the Quito victors, who would also pay with the same coin to a different master who was getting closer and much crueler than they were. My son, you should have never maltreated the ambassadors of Atahualpa. You deserve all that's happening to you. His mother slapped Huáscar, was tied down on a wooden stretcher, a most humble position for a son of the sun. The Quitos punished the priests and generals of Huáscar by letting heavy stones fall on their backs, breaking their spines to never again do sacrifices or fight. Chalcochima, the Lord of Quito, is sending his high priest Cusi Yupanqui to see what to do with Huáscar and his family. He's going to be more severe than we are. Kiss, I have come with strict orders from Atahualpa to eliminate all traces of the Inca dynasty. It is known that the next Inca leaders tried to erase all the deeds of their predecessors and start a new period. Atahualpa may have taken this anomaly to extremes due to their civil war. He would get rid of most of the lineage of Huáscar, the storytellers, and their string keeper writings. That is one reason why our history is a distorted one. Justice over, only a few brothers and close relatives of Huáscar survived, some by escaping and others by siding with Atahualpa. Huáscar, his wife, and their children were spared. Cusi Yupanqui, we have found the mummy of Tupac Yupanqui, the conqueror of Quito. Kiss, rattle that mummy on the streets until the last of his bones are scattered all over. Terror following the city of stones, where the boulders of the great fortress witness what happened to the Incas, and will still continue perpetrating justice among ourselves. Sometimes I feel like a betrayer for portraying my ancestor as having exclusivity on cruelty. Nevertheless, our past has to be told as it occurred, if it did, so it will not be repeated again, hoping that we will evolve into beings capable of goodwill, at least towards our own. While these events were taking place in Cusco, I went to seek some solace with a civilized man created by a true God. My soul was shattered after witnessing the atrocities committed by uncivilized people who worship false idols. Condor Soul, where have you been? You seem to be distressed. Oh, Don Francisco, I have been to the place where you so much want to go. When you get there, I hope your God will redeem the blood splatter in the city that saw the rise of the Incas, and I will attest its demise by strangers who will spill more blood than they ever did. Man of the future, you are drunk with that horrible teacher. No, I am inebriated with the weakness of man, of man against man, something incomprehensible among human beings. After a 2 month stay in Puecos, the Spaniard continued to the valley of Tangarara, where the first city council was formed in San Miguel de Piura. The governorship was given to Hernando Pizarro, instituting the first oligarchies in Peru. Capito, a noble about Atahualpa, has been with us in disguise. He's not as humble as the rest of the Indians. He wants to see you. Filipillo asked him why he hasn't told us that he was an emissary of Inca. Bearded men, you are a bunch of thieves. Atahualpa wants back all the gold that was stolen from him. Hernando, this Indian doesn't know whom he is talking to. Torture him. When he comes to his senses, bring him to me. The spy envoy of Atahualpa understood who the invaders were. Sinkichara, did the stranger treat you well? Great Atahualpa, there are so few that I can kill them if you give me 500 warriors. I would only spare the smith who forges swords, the trainer who tames the horses, and the barber who makes anyone look good. Atahualpa did not allow him to go after them. Instead, he instructed his troops to destroy the towns where the Spaniards were passing through, so that none of his subjects would align with them. Francisco, so far Atahualpa has not attacked us. That means he wants us to go where he is. We have waited too long for Almagro. It is time that we leave these coastal lands. No, we have to wait for my partner. Francisco, without him, the empire will be ours. Hernando, how are we going to confront the thousands of Indians with a few of us? We won't need Almagro. If we take the Inca hostage. His brother convinced Francisco. Pizarro spoke to his men. The Spaniards, those who want to stay in San Miguel, this is the time to choose. Those who desire to continue, follow me. Of the 200 men, 5 of the infantry and 4 of the cavalry decide to stay. The rest follow Francisco. They had nothing to lose in an expedition where death was no longer a constant companion. Don Francisco, our history makes us believe that only a few of you conquered the Incas. If that was true, then it was not a war, but a genocide. What else could it have been? The chroniclers portray you as heroes because nobody wants to be win an easy war. Words. Why don't you accept that we did what we did was boldness in our part? Don Francisco, your courage against backward people is not in question. History is for distorting the facts to morally subdue a race that innocent let the old world rape the new world. Unfortunately, mankind keeps on sterilizing the annihilation of the Indians of all the Americas. Man of the future, that happened 500 years ago. Do I complain about the Moors who occupied Spain for 7 centuries? No, because in the end you won, whereas we are still under the shadows of usurpers who are now in us. I hope that in this encounter, conquerors and conquered mend their wrong deeds so that you can save your souls and the Indians regain their dignity. To accomplish that, we need your help. How am I going to help? I am as dead as the dust that you are stepping on. As dead as you are, let your soul make me understand why I feel so remorseful for something that happened so long ago. Man of the future, what you need to do is to think of yourself as the very Spaniard who conquered you. Why do you have to identify with the vanquished? Who in the world gives a dharma for an Indian who doesn't rise above his Indianism? Stop calling yourself Indian or mestizo. No one does. That thinking is that what I would like to change. Mierda, history will take its course regardless of what you write or say. You must do as I did, kill for God, gold, fight for glory, and the apostles of religion will redeem your soul. As it is, I cannot let my name be used out of all things to regain the dignity of the Indians. Do you think that any Spaniard, or for that matter, any mestizo, even an Indian, is going to help you in a hopeless cause? Instead of whining, you should pick up the sword and fight for justice. Don Francisco, I was hoping that the soul changes with our death. I see that I'm wrong. Yes, you are. Only through our actions one can right the past. Speaking of actions, it is time to go and meet that Indian who calls himself the Lord of the world. For five months, they have been scouting the coast. On September 24th, they left San Miguel de Piura, arriving at a valley where they established another city, which was closer to the ocean. In this reverse of the times, I encountered Atahualpa. I see that you are now the Lord of the Empire. Yes, man of the future, I'm the Tixicapa. I was on my way to Cusco to make it official when the strangers appeared. I don't know who they are or what they are here for. I had to decide what I'm going to do with them. They have already ransacked the coast. Why are you procrastinating? If history was reversible, you would have already destroyed them. As a man of war, I'm intrigued with their scepter of thunder and their swords. If I had those killing instruments, I would be the greatest warrior ever. That is why I'm wondering how to get what they have. But I will not go to the coast to apprehend them. They have already made alliances with the coastal people. You should have helped them when they were asking you to get rid of their intruders. It is too late for you to do anything. I will wait for the bearded man in Cajamarca, where I will take care of them. Rumiñahui, go to Cacas and Huancabamba. Once there, punish the people who had allied with Huascar and invite the strangers to come to Cajamarca. The invading forces arrived at Pabur, closer to the Cordilleras where Francisco heard reports of Atahualpa's troop. Soto, go up to Cajas and see what's happening. I will be waiting for you in Serran. With 50 men, Soto climbs the Cordilleras and he finds the city destroyed, but the temple untouched. The Spaniards take the 500 Virgins of the Sun to the center of the plaza, and in plain light, they rape them. Afterwards, they continue to Huancabamba on the great royal roads, so spacious that 6 horses could gallop abreast. Although surrounded by Rumiñahui troops, Soto's men were not harmed. 8 days later, they returned. What news do you bring from the Andes? Francisco, there are so many warriors. I don't see how we're going to fight them if they attack us. I received their emissaries who asked us to return the gold that we took from the temple. Soto, I wonder why Atahualpa warriors didn't confront you. His troops were not after us. They were after their own. They killed more Indians than we could possibly do ourselves. The way they did, it is something that I don't want that to happen to us. Capito, there is an embassy bringing you gifts. Francisquillo, open those packages and see what is in them. Capito, look at these 2 miniature fortresses. carved in stone, and these smoke ducks without their heads. I don't understand. Atahualpa has been providing us with all that we need, food we have. These presents tell us something. I think these two fortresses mean their strength, and the headless dogs what it's going to do with us. Francisquillo, give these mirrors for the messenger and this silk shirt for the Inca. With the new intelligence, the Spaniards continue. 5 days later, they arrived at Cinto, where Pizarro sent a young noble to tell Atahualpa that he was on his way to see him. The invaders continued to Sanya. Hernando, what to do? We're at the intersection of two great roads. We either continue to Chincha or go east, where Atahualpa is. Francisco, we already made contact with the emissaries. Why not proceed to Cajamarca? Pizarro decided not to continue south on the well-paved coastal road. Instead, he elected to go east and climb the Andes. In Sanya, they saw men who were hung from the trees for trying to reach to rebel against Atahualpa. The fact that he could kill his own people frightened the Spaniards. Aware of what could happen to them, Francisco harangued his troops. Men, do not fear the desolation caused by Atahualpa. These Indians harm only themselves. He has made it possible for us to come this far. Let us continue. In spite of what history tells us of their fears, the invaders knew that they would prevail. The Indians were civilized, and among civilized people, it is all about cunning and not brute force. So, another map showing the routes of Pizarro and Hernando. From the lowlands, they began trekking the high sierras, not knowing that in 1 week they would end the empire. Hernando, the coldest places in Spain are not frigid as in these cordilleras. It's so high that I can't breathe. The Indians who are carrying our heavy loads don't seem to get exhausted. We don't even feed them. They only chew coca. Their women carry their children on their backs and at their breast without complaining. Francisco, they are Indians. They also know that they can lose their heads if they tire or get sick. Capito, there is another embassy from the Inca. They say that Atahualpa has returned to Cajamarca to receive you. The next day, Sunday, November 10, they received Cinquinchara, accompanied by cortege of fine-looking women bringing food and chicha. The emissary told the captain that the Inca was waiting for them and to hurry up. Capito, the young noble that you sent to Cajamarca is back. He says that contrary to what these well-dressed Indians are telling you, Atahualpa has intentions of killing all of you. Infuriated, the young noble attacked Cinquinchara, pulling his golden earplugs. Apparently, as an ambassador of Francisco, he was not well received, and he resented that the emissary of Atahualpa was so well treated by the Spaniards. Hernando, how can that be? Atahualpa has helped us all the way. Now I hear that he wants to get rid of us. It is too late to turn back. If we do, Atahualpa troops will kill us on the way down. Let us keep on going. It is now or never. Life without gold is not worth living. On November 15, the Spaniards arrived to the heights overlooking the green valley of Cajamarca. I have admired that same view. perhaps from the very same vantage point that Francisco once may have contemplated the city below. Now, those mountains of the past are being cut away by foreign miners, contaminating the soil with the mercury of their greed, like the conquerors desecrate our lands with the blood of our ancestors. Francisco saw the magnificent stone building that surrounded the Plaza of Cajamarca. In our days, only the imprisonment house of Atahualpa is still standing to remind us that this is where the last Inca lived. One wonders what Atahualpa had in mind when he saw them. To think that he could have exterminated the intruders the very moment they entered the empire. That inability to kill of our own for our own survival is what they make us into Indians. Atahualpa, look at the strangers on the heights of Sichuana. Are you going to let them come down? Cut your soul. I'm not going to worry about thieves who can't even trek the mountains. They are going to pay for raping the young women and stealing our gold. Thus, in one November of the past, our end came to pass, and we will never have the Januaries of hope. Don Francisco, finally you are at the threshold of greatness. You will go into the pages of history as the hero who conquered an empire, but you will be a villain in the hearts of those who are just. Condor soul, you don't know yet, in that valley below, we will encounter the most powerful lord of this land. When we get down, those green meadows will become the valley of death for them or for us. It has been 8 long years since my first expedition. Now I am face to face with my destiny. Your destiny, how about theirs? I don't give a damn what happened to them. Where soldiers of fortune will live by the sword. Don Francisco, you are no longer seekers of fortune, but the soldiers of a mighty kingdom. As its subjects, you should represent the noblest ideas of your nation. Man of the future, you are still the same men thirsting for wealth and willing to fight to get it. If we live, we are going to line our pockets with gold. If we die, the crown and the Pope will get other adventures to finish what I started. As you can see, by giving our lives, we're also nobles at heart. Francisco, look in the distance, row upon row of tents of thousands of warriors. I'm afraid we're falling into a trap. We're so few. Soto, we're few, but we're also astute. And we have to be. Let us descend to Cajamarca. Francisco harangues his men. Españoles, we're not a large army, but we have the cojones to fight these superstitious Indians. Today we will either be the richest men on earth or die for the glory of God. Have no fear, Santiago will be with us. Atahualpa, you are finally going to meet the strangers as they are and not as what you thought they were. Contorso, this is something I have never imagined. Men with resplendent shields mounted on huge animals. Everything on them shines. I wonder if they are the sons of the sun and not the bearded men who are terrorizing my people. Whoever they are, they will die if they are coming to fight. Or be my allies if they are the messengers of Inti. Atahualpa, if you are in doubt, why are you letting them come down to your city? Can you realize that if they take the plaza, they will have an advantage over you? Here you are bathing in the hot springs as if what you are seeing is not actually happening. As a man of war, you should protect the very place where you live. Of course, I have thought of all those possibilities. Once they are inside the wall plaza, they will not have a way out. Look around. Can you see the 1,000 warriors ready to take my orders? I have also sent Rubinyawi to the surrounding mountains to apprehend the strangers who are trying to escape or come to my rescue if I am in trouble. The other reasons why I sent my one-eyed general out of the city is that he is on the same opinion as my other generals: kill the strangers. But I want to know for myself, who are they? So far, they have only talked to my emissaries and not to me. I have to see them face to face before I know what to do with them. Sapa Inca, for the future of our race, don't let the Spaniards in. If you do, your descendants will live to regret what you are about to do. You are calling me Lord. Why now? Because you will be the last sovereign who will end with the Inca Empire. You who have won all there was to win, do not lose all there is to lose. Hernando, I cannot believe that a warrior emperor is letting us coming down to his city without opposing us. Santiago, guarded our citadel in the last, to the last of our men. Only then Moors could take Trujillo. The invaders entered the outer limits of Cajamarca. They marched to the fenced triangular plaza with only two entrances, with no doors. It seemed to have been designed for the purpose that the Incas had in mind. Instead, it happened the reverse. Ever since, we have been enclosed within those walls of the past. As they enter into the heart of Cajamarca, only the ominous note of a quena flute played by a blind man echoed in the far Andes. Men, fear not. All we have to do is to enter the plaza that has been reserved for us and fight to keep it. Once inside, they took over the main buildings for their protection and comfort. Francisco began to plan the logistics before nightfall. Meanwhile, up on the mountains, the 1,000 warriors were lighting their torches and the fire pits to keep themselves warm. Soto, before it gets dark, go with 20 mountain men to the spring bath where the Inca is. Tell him to come and dine with me tonight. Don Francisco, you have the audacity to invite the owner of the house to have supper with you. These are not the manners of a well-bred Spaniard. Condor soul, this is not a war of etiquette. What do these Indians know about chivalry? They are probably planning to get rid of us. As far as I'm concerned, this is my house. It could also be my tomb. We're fighting for the survival of the most astute and not necessarily the strongest. Don Francisco, these people are not the pigs that you once herded. They are human beings capable of benevolence, if you are benevolent to them. We will find out in due time if these Indians are what you say they are. Soto's party, with Filipillo sitting behind him, began trotting over streams of vaporizing volcanic waters. Through the mist, the Inca warriors seemed perplexed to see men and beasts as one floating in the haze. To them, perhaps centaurs, as the chroniclers write. Taking less time than it would have taken the natives, they reached the wooden bridge not fit to be crossed by horses. Instead, they stampeded across the shallow stream at the sounds of the iron hoofs, resonance never heard on these lands. Oye, Indio, where is the Inca? Felipillo, be careful how you treat them. Don Hernando de Soto, to me they are just as Indian as they are to you. Huiracochas, the great Tixicapa is in his bathhouse. As they arrived to the stone house, the Inca was notified that the Apu Machu, or old man, as Francisco was called, didn't come. Atahualpa wanted to talk to him or someone of his lineage. Francisco, Soto is taking too long. Something is not going well. I should go to find out what's happened, or at least have a show of force with more cavalry. Hernando, go and don't humiliate the Incas with your arrogance. We are in no position to fight them. We must apprehend Atahualpa at the right time, and that moment is not now. Galloping on a line of cautious llamas, the 15 mountain men arrive at the baths of the Inca. Soto, why is Atahualpa behind that veil? Have you been able to talk to him? Hernando, I am following the orders of Francisco to be patient with the Inca. Atahualpa doesn't want to talk to anyone, but to the old man. Don Hernando Pizarro, he said that since you are his brother, he will talk to you. Felipillo, who do you think am I? I'm as noble as the Pizarros. Señor Soto, I am not making that distinction. Atahualpa is. He knows that Don Francisco is the Apu Machu, and his brother is a noble like him. Soto, you and I know who we are. I will do the talking if that's what the Inca wishes. Finally, the veil was removed. Atahualpa, still looking at the stone floor, made no visual contact with the strangers or showed any interest in their horses. His nobles, however, were awed by the sight of bearded men mounted on animals, scraping the ground as they were getting ready to run over them. The initial fears subsided in each body. Filipillo, now standing on ground, began to translate directly to Atahualpa. The Inca answered nothing. The translator should have been talking to his alter ego, Marca Vilca, who would hear and speak for the Inca. He was the Curaca of Poecos, who was humiliated by the Spaniards and now one of the principal nobles of Atahualpa because he knew about them. The Inca lords, as it was their custom, was not going to talk to a Yanacona servant or any Spaniard whom he knew could steal and fornicate. The rules of translation understood. Hernando's words were addressed to the Inca through his representative, making sure that the dialogue was not between Atahualpa and Filipillo, but Hernando and Marca Vilca. Atahualpa, my brother wants you to come to dine with him and pay his respect to such a magnificent warlord. The Inca kept looking at the floor. He answered nothing. In disconcert, Soto, who was a fine horseman, began to make a show of his equestrian powers that would have astounded anyone, especially seen for the first time. The sovereign had his sight at the faraway mountains that were taking an orange hue. Frustrated, and to get him out of his stupor, Soto spurred his horse, charging straight towards the Inca. The animal stopped with its front legs pawing in the air, barely missing him while foaming hot saliva that spattered on Atahualpa's clothing. The Inca didn't portray any sign of pain, panic, but his guard backed up. They would later be hanged for being unable to restrain their fears. Finally, in a high stylized Quechua, Atahualpa spoke. That is enough. In a defiant voice, he addressed them through his alter ego. I understand that the Curaca Otumbes killed three of your warriors and one horse, which proves to me that you are not demigods. Inca Marca Vilca is not telling you the truth. Hernando has been talking to Atahualpa in a defiant tone, in spite of early recommendations from Francisco to oblige the Inca, a most difficult behavior to sustain for any Spaniard. Soto, it is insulting that an Indian doesn't talk directly to me. I don't care if he's the lord of the land. Hernando, be calm. Atahualpa knows that we are warriors, like him, but his people don't know that. Humble yourself, at least for this time. In a sudden change of mood, the Inca gave a faint smile, putting his nobles at ease. With a facial gesture, he commanded to bring chicha for the mountain man. Soto, I'm not going to drink any of their brew. Hernando, if we don't, he might feel insulted. Inca, let us toast to our alliance. Will you come tonight and dine with our good captain? Marca Vilca, tell that I am fasting. I will be there tomorrow to see their Apu Machu. The first meeting with Atahualpa had ended. The Spaniards left as fast as they came, wondering about what transpired. Hernando, I am concerned. Atahualpa is not a stupid Indian, as you tend to think of them. He's the most dignified of all the caciques we have encountered. He could have done away with us, and he hasn't. Why not? What does he want from us? Who are these possessed Spaniards? And why we're in the New World, trying to get what we don't have, whereas they have enough gold to cover Spain, metal for which we're willing to die. Soto, that is our advantage. We know what we want. The only thing that is making him doubt is that we are just as human as they are. But to us, they are other than human beings. Have no fear. We shall prevail by the will of our man God, who exists, whereas their sun God only shines. Hernando, don't be so impudent. We have just seen a defiant warlord with all the powers to kill us, and that is what we have to tell your brother. That was the first encounter of the Incas with the Spaniards. Atahualpa, you have faced the so-called Wiracochas. What are you going to do with the invaders? Kutursol, I'm not frightened by them. Those who were afraid are now hanging from the trees. Tomorrow, the bearded man will pay for all that they have done. Inca, a mountain man is equivalent to 100 of your warriors. You are at a disadvantage. I'm so sure of our superiority in numbers that I myself will go to the square, and just seeing my entourage, they will prostrate to my feet. You are betting the whole empire to prove that you can impose yourself over the few of them. When are you going to act like you did with your enemies, so decisive and merciless against your own? This is the time to be unforgiving with the strangers. Man of doom, since you know what took place in our history, tell me what's going to happen. Oh, Incas, what befell upon us is written in my soul. That same anguish is pressing in the millions of your descendants who live in misery as a result of what you're about to do. Am I responsible for that? Within 24 hours, you will be. Are you instilling fear in me instead of giving me an insight of what I must do or what I should have done? Inca, I have just told you the results of your short-sightedness. I made peace with Atahualpa and left him somewhat consternated at the prospect of a latter days in the past. Hernando, what happened? Is he coming to dine with me? Francisco, Atahualpa is a proverbial Indian who needs to learn some civility. As usual, your arrogance overcome you. Soto, what do you have to tell me? Capitan, what we have seen and heard doesn't look or sound too good. Atahualpa is going to kill all of us tonight or tomorrow. We're surrounded by 30,000 Indians with not a chance against them. This time, Santiago is not going to help us. What to do? Condor Sol, you also seem to be apprehensive for what is about to take place. Don Francisco, how I wish that apprehension was for me alone. The event I soon to unfold is going to be a catastrophic consequence to our people. Never in the history of mankind has a civilization lost so much and for all epochs to come. Can you understand my anguish? Man of the future, we're the ones who are going to lose our lives if we don't apprehend the Inca. In the end, only your lives are at stake. What I am talking about is the Holocaust of a civilization. Nonsense. This is just another raid against the same savage that we have been exterminated, except that the Incas have more gold and the ability to butcher among themselves. We annihilate them now or in your times, they are not lost to anyone. They are not even considered humans. So, if they are not human beings, how can that be a Holocaust? Francisco Pizarro was at the culmination of all that he has suffered. And in his mid-50s, he knew that if he died, it would not have been in vain. He was afraid as the rest, but he would not share his fear with them. This was the time to show his audacity. He spoke to his men.